The importance of the anthropological turn, the turn towards the human subject, particularly in the magisterium of John Paul II, left unexplicitated where we begin. And what I am insisting on is that we begin not with individual autonomy, as Professor Royal has explained, but rather with relationships. That it is relationship that is not just the context for self-understanding, but which constitutes the self, and which we come to understand through lived experience, as well as through more theoretical instruction. In other words, every one of us is born related, someone's son, someone's daughter, someone's sister, someone's brother or cousin, before we know at all who we are, before we can think self-consciously. And we are reborn, if baptized as infants, in the same way, before we come to understand through experience and through God's grace what is life in Christ Jesus. The center, therefore, in this thesis of pastoral and social theology remains obviously always Christ himself and the mystery of the Incarnation. But in particular, I would argue that must be expanded, especially after the Second Vatican Council, to ecclesiology. The theory of the spiritual relationships that constitute the church interiorly and the church in her relationship to the world. And there is a particularly providential moment in beginning with ecclesiology because it is a spiritual counterpart of ecological consciousness that tells us how everything material is interrelated. And therefore, the old method of analyzing in detail the nature placed in the laboratory that we use to examine nature and bend her to our purposes is no longer sufficient for understanding even the material world. We must see the interconnections, the relationships, the whole, if we are to understand the material world of which we are part, but which we transcend because we are spiritual, and it is the ecclesiology of communion that gives us the ecology of spiritual relationships that finally complete our understanding of who we are. Because of this, Benedict XVI, who is becoming more and more noted for his ecological consciousness, coming from ecclesiology, asked in Caritas in Veritate for a special attention to be paid to the category of relationship. The pastoral challenge, first of all, is to see the church related to the world in such a way that the church is not taken over by the world, that it is not co-opted, that it is not itself secularized in its internal life, which sometimes has happened since the council. And on the other hand, to see that the church is not isolated from the world, a kind of a sect that exists in her own corner of the world without influencing, without being the leaven for the transformation of the world. Benedict says human development is impossible, therefore, without this vision of how everything is related. The three sections of the book speak about the various types of relationships that constitute the whole of which the church is to be the agent for transformation. Talks about the universal communion, which is the church's mission. It talks about the hierarchical communion, which is the church's life. It talks about divine communion, communion with God, which is the church's goal here and in the hereafter. It does, in attending to relationship, go into an analysis, a philosophical analysis of that category that the Pope asks us to think of in the epilogue, which is the most philosophically complicated of the chapters, and in some ways theoretically the most important. What the book does is to take the categories given us by Aristotle about living in and living with, and explains that the category necessary for understanding ecclesial communion brings us to living through, an esse per, which is not yet adequately theoretically explored in either philosophy or in Christian theology. But the elements are there, not only in Aristotle, but the way Aristotle was transcended by Thomas Aquinas when he broke up the Aristotelian categories in order to speak of the Holy Trinity and speak of the relationship between God and creation. The Aristotelian categories were insufficient, and so I examine how Aquinas recast them. There is, however, in American thought, which is post-Cartesian, and very often in classical American philosophers argues against the isolation of the individual, that is, the heritage of Cartesian philosophy, to an examination of community. And one American philosopher in particular, Josiah Royce, has been very influential in American political and social philosophy in the way that he tries to create, theoretically, a sense of interpretation that enables divisions between individuals to be overcome by putting everything into terms of three, so that every time there is division, there is always an interpreter, a mediator, a judge, which is able to explain one party to the other. In American political parlance, that has come to be called the beloved community, a term that was much used by Martin Luther King Jr. and has been resurrected in our public discourse by President Barack Obama. Josiah Royce's beloved community is not adequate for understanding Catholic theology of communion, but it is very helpful, particularly helpful in giving us categories in my country for trying to translate Catholic theology into something that the intellectual class will understand because they come out of that philosophical tradition. But the last anthropologist, philosophical anthropologist, whom I used to try to understand better what kind of relationship we're talking about when we're talking about ecclesial communion and a fortiori human solidarity, is Karl Wojtyla, who has a very extended phenomenology of subjective self-consciousness, where he moves from consciousness of an object known through consciousness of the subject knowing the object through consciousness of the subject knowing the subject himself, what he calls reflexive consciousness. This gives the theoretical categories for understanding the biblical names for the church, and the argument in the book is that these biblical names are not merely metaphors. They are rather names of relationships. The church is not a Hegelian substance. It is not something that supersedes individuals because they are subsumed into it. It is rather a network of relationships. So the individual remains always the object of God's love. But the individual is not constituted without these relationships in human solidarity and in ecclesial communion. Let me quote just a paragraph of that last chapter to see how what I am saying throughout the whole book finally informs the theology of communion by working through categories of self-consciousness through biblical metaphors. The church is aware of herself as vital and so calls herself a body. The church is aware of herself as personal and so calls herself a bride who surrenders herself to Christ. The church is aware of herself as subject, as an active abiding presence that mediates a believer's experience, and so calls herself mother. The church is aware of herself as integrated, and so describes herself as temple of the Holy Spirit, a missionary body able to communicate Christ's message and life to the whole world. The unity of shared reflexive self-consciousness among separate entelechies, or personal supposita, living through each other, is strong enough, thick enough, to carry realist predicates. not just metaphor, products of our imagination by making comparisons, but rather names of relationships which are the ultimate reality, the stuff of the Church and of the human subjects and of God himself in the mystery of the Blessed Trinity. So it is a rather extended argument for the primacy not of substance but of relationship, without falling into a Hegelianism that destroys individual freedom.